with utmost respect to the Commission, according to me, there is no need for amending the Constitution. The Constitution as it stands today is very clear on the subject. The executive has no power without the authority of the Parliament. And therefore, there is no need to amend the Constitution. Therefore, all acts which are being done by the executive without the authority of law are, as I said, both unconstitutional and undemocratic. Now, what is the way out? I have in mind two remedies. The two remedies are either you approach the Supreme Court to get a clarification on this subject, which is of course a dilatory process. That no treaty, no agreement, either with the foreign country or foreign organization, not only on this subject, for any subject whatsoever, will ever become binding on the country unless and until it is ratified by the Parliament. That is a quick solution. And if you have, my friends, majority in the Parliament today, you can get this legislation passed. Introduce this bill and urge the members of the Parliament to safeguard their rights and safeguard the rights of the people. So, it is not as if we are without a remedy. The present unlawful activities of the Union Executive can be put an end to, and the remedy is in our hand. This is as far as the constitutional position is concerned. As regards the treaty itself, many have written on the subject, many have also spoken on the subject. It is not necessary for me to dilate on it. But it has become necessary to emphasize certain points, because I find that some government spokesmen have been arguing as if they are holding a brief for a client and arguing in a court of law. They must remember that they have to argue for the nation, in the interest of the nation, and not be bound by their present loyalties, whatever they are. Now the treaty itself begins, Article 2.1, in specific language, that this treaty will be subject to the internal laws of both the countries. It begins with this statement. Now, is there any possibility of a second interpretation to say that the treaty will not be governed by the internal laws of the United States? But the matter does not end there. The internal laws, not only which are at present in operation, but which may also come in future, even the amendment of the present laws and the new laws, will govern the operation of the treaty. That is what it means. And this has again been repeated in Articles 3 and 3.3 and 5.2 of the same treaty. It has been emphasized that the provisions of this treaty will be applicable, will be subject to the internal laws of the US. Now, therefore, there should be no controversy on the subject. But we are told that the present president of the United States has assured our present prime minister that the internal laws will not be applied, that he is passing on letters. Mr. Bush is writing letters to the Congress and so on and so forth. Now, it doesn't require your elementary knowledge of law for citizens to know that these letters, oral assurances cannot override the express provisions of law. And the present president will not be there forever. And even if he is there, he is not bound by it. The present prime minister, may God save him, may not be some other prime minister. So these assurances, oral assurances, passing on letters outside the provisions of the treaty or the law are never binding on nations. Are we living in a world of make-believe? That's a question. Are we running the regime, running the affairs of the country, or running the affairs of a family? If we are running the affairs of the country, we can't afford to be that gullible. We can't afford to be led by such statements made by one or the other gentleman. Now, as I pointed out, this treaty is subject not only to the present laws but also the future laws. Now, in order to say the operation of the internal law, there is always in some treaties and agreements made a provision, specific provision, that the parties to the treaty will not shun the operation of the treaty, taking shelter behind their internal laws. A specific provision is made in the agreement itself. Therefore, under the international law, the treaties have to be operated without subjecting them to the operation of the internal law. But only if such a provision is there, and that is a provision in some of the treaties. One, I have seen a Chinese agreement, for example. The Chinese agreement had made it clear, for having learned lessons in the past, that, and this is an agreement entered into with the US, and that US will not take shelter behind the non-implementation of the treaty on the ground that its internal laws do not permit. Not only our treaty does not have any such agreement, but on the such clause, but on the contrary, it specifically says that it will be subject to the internal laws of the country.